Good morning. Welcome to Sandersville United Methodist Church, and we'd like to welcome each and every one of you to our morning worship today. We're so excited to have you guys all with us. Man, this is a great crowd, isn't it? I know that, like all of us, we're a little bit ready just to start being able to do this together and worship together, and we're thankful that we're able to do that. We have a few announcements that I'd like to get started. First and foremost, I'd like to recognize the rosebud on the altar is in honor of Liam James Brandon, born March 2nd, 2021, son of Jim and Ashlyn Douglas Brandon. This is Randy's, Brandon's grandson. So we just want to say congratulations to them and welcome. Coming up here pretty soon, the United Methodist women are going to be meeting back March 17 at 1 o'clock for their Bible study. This is a great group of ladies. If you are interested in meeting with the United Methodist women, please check in up here in the office. Today we're starting back with a lot of youth stuff. Last Tuesday we started with our boys youth group, small group study, and it was great, had a good group. Today, at 4 p.m., the middle school ladies will be at the Heinemann's house. And my wife and Molly McAfee are the small group leaders for that. If you have a child that's in middle school and would like more information, you can track down either Molly or Andrea, and they'd be happy to talk to you, or myself, and we'd be happy to talk to you. The high school ladies will be at 6 p.m. at the Everett's house. Katie Everett and a few others, Megan Lord and Brittany Price, typically go in and work on that group. We have some of the best small group leaders I think I've ever seen here, and we're thankful for them. But that will be at 6 p.m. at the Everett's. Also, confirmation retreat, y'all please be in prayer for us. This is a fun, great group. Right now, we are talking about some amazing but heavy stuff. And so just be in prayer for that group, that the Lord would work in our hearts, and I'm so thankful for them. It is a shot of life to be able to hang out with them every week. Anyway, so that retreat is next weekend. Daylight Savings is coming up, Blue Bag Sunday, and Palm Sunday is all coming up. In the meanwhile, thank you for coming, and I'll turn it over to Terry. So every week, the staff, we have the privilege of listening to Terry come in and practice. And it's such a privilege, y'all, to have Terry here because he, when he plays, he worships the entire time. And so just sitting in this chair listening to him hum along as he plays so beautifully is so refreshing that he's leading us in worship and something like that. So refreshing. Our first hymn today is "To God Be the Glory." If you will, stand with us. As you stand, feel free to say, "Hey," to everybody around. "Hey, what's up?" The verses are in our bulletin. Standing with us as we recite the Apostles' Creed, or affirmation of our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Before the prayers of the people, Pastor Stan has a few updates for us.
Good morning. I'd like to give you some prayer requests and prayer updates. We regret to inform you that Linda Goodman has had another death in her family. Edna Kaiser, who was in a nursing home over in Alabama, she's a longtime resident of Dublin, Georgia. It was in Alabama at a nursing facility at the time of her death. She passed away yesterday. I understand that the Townsend Funeral Home is in charge of those arrangements, and I'm sure we'll be announcing the particulars a little later on this week. Also, we want to continue to remember Brownie Barksdale and the loss of her brother, Tommy Thomas. Tommy had some pre-existing physical conditions around 74 years of age, and he contracted COVID, developed double pneumonia very quickly, was hospitalized in Johnson City, Tennessee, but has had a very, very difficult time, obviously, and has succumbed in that battle. The funeral was yesterday, so please pray for Sonny and for Brownie and that entire family. Also, we want to keep you updated on Dean McCaskill. Dean has been through a great deal. He has been moved out of ICU into a regular room at the hospital, but he is still awaiting transfer to a long-term care facility. They are hoping they can get him to Tifton, where he'll be near one of the sons, one of his sons. And in connection with that, I was talking with Yvonne late yesterday. She took a fall in the parking lot at the hospital leaving, and she has a bone fracture and some stitches. It just seems like when it rains, it pours. So if you want to reach out to Yvonne, send her a card, make a call, send her a text. I know she's overwhelmed with calls, but she's very, very devoted to Dean, and I sort of gave her permission to stay at home and rest today, for whatever that means. That's like the preacher giving you a hall pass and saying you don't have to go to church on Sunday, so take advantage of it while you can. I see Denise and Lauren here. David Ray is home after what turned out to be quadruple bypass surgery, and he's resting. I talked to him last night and seems to be doing well, and so let's continue to remember David as he recovers. Also, Larry Smith. Is Larry here today? I think he was playing. There he is back there. Larry has had shoulder surgery, one step at a time, becoming the bionic man. And he has had shoulder replacement surgery this week and wanted to be in church today. So, Larry, we're glad to see you. You might not want to pat him on the shoulder this morning. I'm sure you've got some soreness there. Isn't it amazing what people... My grandmother was born in 1900. And she suffered with very severe rheumatoid arthritis all of her life, after the last third of her life, I would say. And all she had was something called Anacin. I think it's still around, and Buffarin, but nothing, none of the stepped-up pharmaceuticals that we have today, and certainly none of the joint replacement therapies that we have today. It's truly amazing what medicine can do today, and we just want to thank God for all the breakthroughs that we've experienced. Understand that Amy Scrooge is going to have a minor procedure this week. We want to remember her in prayer. And we also want to ask you to remember Scott Glenn. This is Felicia's husband. He's going to have a procedure on his back tomorrow. Felicia does plan to come into the office, but maybe afternoon before she gets here. Eric, would you lead us in prayer, please?
Father, we come to you thankful that we get to be in church today. Lord, your psalmist would say it is good to be back in the house of the Lord. Lord, I see so many people today that are smiling and that they're happy to be back here. Lord, today as we come, let us worship you. Father, let us be thankful for this opportunity. Let us remember what it is as we are in this Lenten season that you have done for us. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your love. Lord, for these needs that Pastor Stan has made mention of, for all of these folks in our congregation who have medical needs, for these families who seem like have endured a loss one right after another. Lord, we pray for your peace. Pray for your grace. Lord, that your work would be done in their lives. Lord, that the church body would be an encouragement to them. We pray, God, that you would just be with them. Lord, as your children, we pray, God, that you would encourage us, speak to our hearts to encourage these people. But we also know that many of these requests have been known, but in a congregation like this, we know that there are so many needs, so many hurts, so many requests that have not been said. Lord, please give each person who has heaviness on them right now, I pray, God, that you would just give grace. Lord, to that person that needs encouragement, let us be your agents of encouragement to them. Lord, again, thank you for the opportunity to come to your house to worship. Speak to our hearts. Be in this place heavy today. In your name we pray. Amen. One of my favorite times of the year is Promotion Sunday. This last year we were not able to do that. And we have a great, great group joining us today. So I'm going to ask Andrea to come up. She's going to help me. So one of the things that we say with Promotion Sunday that's so awesome is that as a church, we get to pass out their first, for many of them, first copy of the scripture. Oftentimes, you know, the big thing with Promotion Sunday is that they're old enough and in school where they can start reading. And so we want, as a church, to be the foundation of the scripture. Just with our Christian ed and things like that, we want our kids from an early age to have a love for the Word of God. And so, as I call your name today, if you are promoting, I want you guys to come on up front to see Miss Andrea, and you're going to stay here. And some of these folks I don't believe are here, but as you guys hear their names at the end, we'll recognize them. But Jacob Boyd, I don't believe Jacob is here today. Laura Bennett Dickey. Liam Hindman. Raylan Johnston. Frank McDaniel. Mitchell Noggle. I don't believe Hudson, but Hudson Price. I'm not sure if he was able to make it today. So in one of the cool things that the United Methodist Church does when kids are baptized into the church, we as a congregation make a commitment that we will be a part of the discipleship process. This is not just a one and done type thing, but it is our job to come alongside the parents to help lead them closer to the Lord. This is a huge thing. It's something that we should not take lightly. It's the reason why I asked so many of you to volunteer for different things. And we're thankful because we do have so many good volunteers. We always need more. Shameless pitch, but I'm going to ask here in just a second Pastor Stan to come up. He's going to pray over these kids, but as you guys see this group, I want you guys to remember to encourage them, to tell them that you're praying for them, to share how God is working in your life. Our children need to see that. So Pastor Stan, can you pray over these promotion Sunday students.
Sure. Let's bow our heads and hearts together in prayer. Father, we're so grateful for the life of each young person, each a creation of yours, each with a divine plan placed in their heart and in their life. Father, I pray for Jacob Boyd today and for Laura Bennett Dickey, for Liam Heineman and for Raylan Johnston, for Frank McDaniel and for Mitchell Noggle and for Hudson Price, that you will place your hand of blessing and guidance upon them as they're stepping into some very important years in their lives. I pray that they will remember this day when they were handed these scriptures, and that they'll remember the words of the psalmist who said, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." May they walk in the light of your word. May they make decisions in their lives that will bring them joy and not heartache. And I pray, Father, that you will see them through every difficulty and trial that may lay ahead in life, and that, Father, you will gather them up in your arms, show them each and every day of their lives the love and grace of God through Jesus, in whose name we pray, and all the people said, amen. Let's give these young people a hand.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I was asked to give a quick update, or a word, not words, as I was reminded, about the Rolling Restart Task Force. We met last Wednesday to discuss the worship needs of the congregation. And just as a reminder, this task force is tasked with the responsibility of balancing our spiritual and worship needs with our continued safety. But with that in mind, the meeting started off with Dr. Tarbutton giving us an update on the recent COVID numbers in the state of Georgia and in our county, along with facts on immunizations. And the trends are consistently going down over the last several weeks. So that's the good news. And it's very evident, if you were here several weeks ago when we started our in-person worships again, the excitement was very palpable. I mean, people were laughing and talking, and whoever was leading that Sunday had a hard time getting the congregation under control so we could start worship service. It was very obvious that it's time, past time, for us to get back together. And one of the many benefits of being in the choir is getting to hear the congregation sing. And this morning when we sang "To God Be the Glory," it's very, very evident sitting up here, and the way you sang is that you are glad to be here this morning and you are ready to worship. Please know that the Rolling Restart Task Force Committee is in full agreement with that that feeling, and unanimously the committee has agreed to really start opening up worship and limiting some of the restrictions that have been put in place over the last several months. We are not ready to make a formal announcement just yet on those lifting of restrictions, but this is really an informal announcement to let you know this morning. Be paying very close attention to your weekly bulletins, because those changes, those announcements will be coming out piecemeal in the coming weeks and even in the coming months as this process develops. So please be reading those bulletins very closely. If you have not done so, this would be a great time to add your email address to the distribution list. So if you are not receiving the weekly bulletins via email, please call the church office. If you have additional emails you'd like to add to the list, please call the church office and get that information updated. And be looking for those lifting of restrictions. I just think it's very apropos that with in-person worship being kind of dormant for most of the winter, that we're coming alive with the dawning of spring. And so that's not been lost on me. So if you have any questions or concerns, I strongly encourage you to reach out to any member of the task force. I'm going to ask Dan, and I'll try to remember to ask Felicia in this week's bulletin to list the task force members. Any questions, concerns, or issues that you would like the committee to address, please reach out to a committee member, and we'll make sure that gets addressed in the next meeting.
Thank you, Carl. One of the things that we have altered is the way we take our offering. We're going to segue back into passing the offering plates eventually, but we are today inviting you to come if you've not brought something forward to place it in the urn that is on the floor in front of the communion table. There are a number of visitors here today, and you're under no compulsion to give at all, but those of you who are part of our church family, we rely upon your continued faithfulness. I do want to say that it is a joy to look out and see Clyde Wright in our service this morning. Clyde is back in service with us, having had his vaccination, and we are, a number of you have already had the vaccination. My wife and I have been, we kind of got in under the wire. Like to say this, I don't get to say this very often, I wasn't really old enough to go with the first round, but I had the right color hair and I got in under the, I appreciate Dr. Tarbutt and Dr. Gatliff advocating for me as a kind of caretaker for people who are at risk. It makes me certainly feel an edge of confidence. We do want you to continue practicing common sense social distancing, and we'll be opening up the seating some, but that is not a signal for you to just throw off all caution to the wind. Please just be aware that we're wanting to temper everything that we do with a degree of caution. So as Terry is playing now, we invite you to come and share in the giving this morning. pre-K, kindergarten, first grade. I'm going to be reading from John, the 9th chapter. While the choir was singing, I thought of a word that my grandfather used to use a great deal, and that word was anointing. He would say, that was an anointed service. That was an anointed song. That is an anointed preacher. It was a carryover from the imagery of the Old Testament tabernacle and temple where the priest would go through and with a special compound of oil symbolize the presence of God on all the instruments of worship, including the priests. They were also anointed. They were anointed in a way that symbolically was permanent, but it was also something indicative in the oil that it needed to be refreshed occasionally. We can't produce that ourselves. That is something that God sends upon us. I believe that we are an anointed church. I believe that I speak for most of us when I say that I can feel the manifest, evident spirit and presence of God here this morning. There are not many occasions that we gather together that we could classify as a dead service. Now, nobody bats 1,000. We have services that we just sort of say, well, that was nice. Sometimes we're tireder when we come into church than we are at other times. I was thinking about Terry going back and forth between these instruments. He has a set of Nikes over here by the organ and PF Flyers over here by the piano. What a wonderful experience it is to experience that part of life that only God can bring to us. But there is a component in our life with God that is hinged upon our willingness and our determination. All of us know what it's like, whether we're competing in athletics or working a job where we get in the zone, but we feel the wind get to our back and we're just being pushed along by something extra. On the other hand, we know what it is to have to be laboring, walking uphill, moving one step at a time. Some of us, many of us, are doing that emotionally. As I look out over this congregation, I think about what we have been through in the last year. And many of us have undergone catastrophic, cataclysmic changes in our lives. Now, the big change, the atmosphere of a pandemic, is subject to change, and we're all looking for that total light at the end of the tunnel. I don't know about you, but I get a little frustrated when I hear one thing one day about what we're supposed to do and another thing another day. I just would like for someone to give me just the facts, like Jack Webb on Dragnet. Just the facts, ma'am. But there has to be in all of us the awareness, the reality, that we have a task to do. There is a part of this task that only God can do. Only God can bring his fullest blessing to it. But there is a work for us to continue to do. I want to lift out a single verse that will intersect with everything that I'm saying this morning, although we will look at the chapter at least in an overview. John chapter 9, verse 4, the words of Jesus. As long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no man can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Again, as long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. For night is coming when no one can work. I was fascinated this past week when I sat down and Googled a National Geographic time lapse of the life of a honeybee. Honeybees are amazing creatures. And as you study them, you realize that there is a lot more to them than just the honey that they produce. I mean, it might seem that honey is not a real heavyweight thing in all the things you consider in the world. But when we consider the connection of the work of these honeybees to our own survival as a human species, it will put you back on your heels. There's a great deal of concern in the scientific community about the decrease in the number of honeybees, because the work that those little bees do, they're sometimes called wonder bees, has a great deal to do with every vegetable that you and I eat and every food that feeds our poultry and our livestock, which in turn helped us to feed us. I believe it was Einstein who said that if the honeybee is ever eradicated, human beings will go quickly down the same path. I, for one, have never understood or never known that. That's never been on my radar. Here's a few facts that you can learn, and I encourage you, by the way, to get with your children. You'll notice the front of the bulletin, we put 10 life lessons from honeybees. Take time to read that. There's a lot of information available, and it would be a fun activity with your children to make life lessons or life applications with your grandchildren, with nieces and nephews, or just something that would apply to your own life. For example, if you take a 16-ounce bottle of our jar of honey, that represents the labor of tens of thousands of bees. On average, for that 16 ounces of honey, there have been bees covering 112,000 miles, gathering nectar from 4.5 million flowers, and foraging bees living 6 weeks, flying 500 miles in as short a time as 20 days. Down inside the hive, the receiver bees deposit the nectar into the cell, and then the bees have what is called a honey stomach, which processes the nectar 200 times before it's placed into the cell. More bees then surround the cells, and when you hear a beehive humming, we had one in the dormer of my mother's house. And you could hear those bees. And what they're doing when you hear that sound is they're flapping their wings to take the water out of that concoction that they put in there. And what is left is honey. Bee farmers don't go in, or harvesters don't go in and take all the honey. They leave enough for the hive to function, and it's the overage that they harvest. We've got a beekeeper right down Church Street here, I believe. See the beehives out in the yard. A fascinating thing. They wax over the end to cap off the cell, and the journey begins for another honeybee. And as my daughter said to me, tongue in cheek yesterday, "Dad, the world's a sweeter place because of the honeybees." Now, this ninth chapter of the Gospel of John starts off with a really odd question. There is a man who is blind, and the Pharisees and some of the people standing around say to Jesus, "Who sinned that this man was born blind?" There has to be a cause and an effect. Who sinned that this man was born blind? Was it he that sinned, or was it he that his parents sinned? And Jesus said, "No, what has happened to him is he's been placed here at this moment so that the work of God can be displayed in him. The time and the moment has come for a miracle in his life." And Jesus stoops down and mixes up a muddy concoction. It's kind of strange what happens here. And he rubs this on the man's eye, tells him to go and wash. The man comes back seeing. The Pharisees hit the roof. They question his parents. They're actually indicting him for maybe, "Have you been faking being blind?" No. His parents said, "No, he was born blind." And all of a sudden, he sees. It is a metaphor for the ability of us to have our eyes open to the light of the kingdom. And the mission that we have in the world is to carry on that same light that Jesus brought into the world. And the urgency of that is undergirded by three things. We must do the work of him who sent me. Now, all of my life as a young person, my family used the King James Version of the Bible. Most of the scriptures I've learned or memorized, I first learned in that. Beautiful translation. I still use it a great deal at funerals. Just a beautiful rhythmic language, that Middle English. But if you remember in there, in this verse, it's actually translated, "I must do the work of him who sent me." If you read it, you'll see it that way. I mean, the reason that the translators thought that was, well, if you look back in Luke chapter 2, where Jesus' first words are recorded, he tells the people in the temple, "Do you not know that I must be about my Father's business?" And then in Luke chapter 4, he said, "I must preach the good news of the kingdom to other towns also, because I've also been sent there." He said to Zacchaeus, "I've got to come down. I must spend the day at your house." And then he said, "I must be lifted up and draw all the world to me." That's going to be significant. And I'll point out what he's getting at when he uses that little Greek word for "we." Jesus was motivated by the will of God, and he was saying to those who were following him, there is a work we must do because it is the will of God that we take ourselves, even when the wind is not in our back, even when we have to purposely step forward, even when we have to walk uphill, because the needs of humanity are great. There are people filling towns and villages in the countryside who've not yet heard the word of Jesus at this time, and a love that he has compels him. My grandmother wrote something down, and I ran across it the other day, and I think you ought to write it down. It's powerful. Written in her little scribble. She said, "Jesus Christ loved more than he lectured." Jesus Christ loved more than he lectured. You know, sometimes the feeling a lecture gives you is this person really doesn't want me to know anything. They just want to get me told. Have you ever practiced what you're going to say to somebody next time you see them when you're upset with them? I mean, most of us do this, and that's why sometimes it's a good thing to step away and cool your jets. I once had a CEO of one of our companies here in town say that when I write a hotly worded letter, I let it sit for at least a week and reread it every morning. It's amazing the adjustments you'll make. Jesus loved more than he lectured. He doesn't characterize, for example, the prodigal son's father is saying, "All right, boy, where have you been? What have you been doing? What happened to your good clothes? And where's the money I gave you?" Instead, he responds with a father's love. You may need this one day. When we steer our lives off track, Jesus Christ still loves us and still wants to embrace us. Amen. When Jesus stood there that day, he understood the necessity of involving us in his work. John chapter 20 and verse 21, he echoes that we must do the work that the Father sent him to do by saying, "As my Father has sent me, I am sending you." There is no one else that can take your place in the plan that God has for your life in God's kingdom. You have a specific and a special place. Sometimes people say to me, "Well, it's a lot easier for you, preacher. I can't talk to people. I freeze up when I start talking about things like that." You know, when I go to the hospital, not so much during COVID, but most of the time I can get in to see anybody most any time. I mean, the doors are just open for preachers. But do you know there are doors in people's lives that they won't open to a preacher? Some will, but a lot of people won't. They're kind of afraid of you. Little boy saw me in the hallway one time at the church where I was pastoring, and he was from Mississippi. He went around the corner, and he said, "Granny, there's a dude in a Batman suit around there." I mean, he didn't know what to make of me. And that's one of the reasons why I kind of come down on the floor and so, you know, you can at least get a good look and say, "Oh, they don't plug him up and roll him off in the corner." I've told you before, the little girl, 6 years old, that saw me in America, she looked me up and down and she said, "You're the church man. What are you doing here at a restaurant?" Humanity helps to touch the humanity of another. As long as it is day, Jesus said, we have to do the work of him who sent me. Virginia Ely wrote these words, and I want you to write it down. You might write it in your children's Bibles that were passed out today. Every person is born into this world as a fresh thought of God and has a work that is born inside them to do. Every person who is born into this world represents a fresh thought of God and has a work that is born within them to do. Life, that is the life of your son, the life of your daughter, the life of your friends, your life. One of the most precious things we have in life is time. Jim Croce said, "If I could save time in a bottle, the first thing that I'd like to do is to save every day till eternity passes away. And again, I'd spend them with you." He wrote that to his wife. No one knew that he was going to die in a plane crash. "If I had a box just for wishes and dreams that have never come true, The box would be empty except for the memory of how they were answered by you. Isn't that beautiful? But there never seems to be enough time to do the things you want to do once you find them. I'm going to preach next Sunday on the passing of time and how it's such a resource for us. But suffice to say that from his baptism to his crucifixion, Jesus had 3.5 years. He moved quickly. His entire ministry, in between his teaching and his healing and his miracles, he was always on the move. He had no place to place his head. If you look back in Greek mythology, there's a god called Kairos. One of the three major sculptors in ancient Greece made a statue of him. And he was on his tiptoes. He had wings. He had a long lock of hair in front. He was bald in the back. He was on his tiptoes because he was moving in your direction quickly. And if you didn't take care of hold of the lock in front of him, if you got behind him, if he got past you, you could never capture him again. And opportunities don't come along every day. Opportunity to set something right. There are four things we never get back: the words we speak, the arrows we fire, the days we've spent, and the opportunities we've neglected. As long as it is day, we must do the work that is given to us. My daughter toured Scotland for her college trip, and she was sent back a sundial to us, and the words are weathered now, but it said, "Take thought of time before time is ended." Take thought of time before time is ended. If you're a parent here today, you may be in the throes of your children in those growing years, in those hectic years. Some of you are in that phase where every one of your children have to have their shoes tied. Anybody ever been there? Getting up on Sunday morning, every one of them have to have their socks put on, their shoes tied. And they move past that, and all of a sudden you realize that they're at another area in their life. I can remember when I thought somebody who was 50 years old was as old as dirt. J.B. Fowler once said that our lives are between two bookends, the wood of the cradle and the granite of the tombstone. And all that we do takes place within those two bookends. And it moves very quickly. If you're a parent, you may feel overwhelmed, but I will guarantee you this: your children won't be children for long. And what you do in their lives, you must do now. I was thinking about how teachers and students, I've got teachers that I think the world, I go back to them every time I can. My eighth grade teacher, Miss Diane Elliott, I love that lady. Every time I get a chance when I'm home, I'll call her and ask her, see how she's doing. She's way up in years now. But you don't have those students forever, do you? They pass through. Think about how many youth groups have gone through this church right here. You know, Victoria had left just before I got here. And then Alexis, she had her time right there in the heart of the youth group. And then now here comes Mary Thomas. Mary Thomas was coming out of the second grade when I met her. Time passes quickly. And what we're going to do, we have to do now. Night is falling. Those bees I talked to you about work in the sunlight. Night is coming when no one can do anything any further. But what we're engaged in doing has eternal value. It would be easy to think that eternity is just something sort of like honey. Well, that's those bees, they make some honey. Good, big deal. But what they're doing is a lot more important to everything that goes on in our lives every day. Every time we pick up a fork, we're connected to the work that they're doing. And I can tell you this, the presence of the church, the presence of the church worldwide is a blessing to this world, whether this world realizes that or not. Every Sunday in the Apostles' Creed, we say these words, speaking of Jesus, who's at the right hand of the Father, from thence he shall come and to pass judgment upon the living and the dead. Somewhere in our human experience in eternity, we stand before God. And one of the things that we're going to be judged about is whether or not we have put our hand to the plow and not looked back. Because Jesus said, if you put your hand to the plow and you spend all your time looking back instead of keeping your eye on the work to do in front of you, he said, you're not worthy of me. Jesus is calling us forward. And as he calls us forward, keep that honeybee in mind. Do you know that archaeologists have discovered honey in the tombs of the pharaohs, and you could still eat it? Wow. What we're doing is vital to the life of this church and the life of this community. And whether the wind is at our back or we're having to lean into the storm, we must work while it is day, for the time is coming when the work will be laid aside and the crowns will be given. And all the people said, amen. Beautiful old song this morning we're going to end with. The words are in your bulletin in the center section. As we're singing this morning, perhaps you might like to come and kneel in a recommitment, in a moment of recommitment to God. That is entirely up to you. But anytime we close a service, during the singing, the altars are always open. It's a tradition in Methodism. Let's stand together. exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call Before all of the pandemic interrupted our way of life and our corporate worship, a number of people have indicated to me that they're interested in perhaps joining our church. We don't push that on people, but if you would like to make inquiry, you're certainly able to. You can call me or call the office, and we'll touch base with you about that. It's not a complicated process. It's not a bloodletting. But we would like to have a heads up so that we can do that in a way that will allow for as many as possible to do that at once. My father-in-law used to say, if all minds are clear, we'll dismiss. But he said, I learned not to ask that in a church, in a room full of church folks. So assuming that all minds are clear and we're ready for dismissal, receive this benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you, and cause his face to shine upon you. The Lord be gracious unto you and give you peace. And all the people said, amen.